O kale o hano o ino
for the months of October, November, and December called Identities Beyond Borders, and it's been a focus on Latin America and the Caribbean. Today, this panel discussion symposium is called Taino Revivalism in the 21st Century, Cultural Heritage of Caribbean Indigenous Peoples. So I won't be taking this role for much longer because we're going to invite our moderator for the day, Dr. Gabriel Hassan Vera, will be coming onto stage and telling you a little bit more about what's going to happen today. So please welcome Dr. Vieira.
Okay, I think I'm going to wait a little bit until the panelists come and take their seats because I want to introduce them as best I can. I'm meeting some of these folks for the first time. Okay, my name is Gabriel Hasler-Viera, and I teach courses in history and sociology at the City College of the City University of New York, and I want to welcome all of you to this panel session at the American Museum of Natural History on Taino Revivalism in the 21st Century, subtitled The Cultural Heritage of Indigenous Peoples in the Caribbean and the Diaspora. This panel session is part of a series of events at the museum titled Identities Beyond Borders, Latin American and Caribbean Heritage, and is going to be subdivided into three parts. In the first part of the session, each panelist will evaluate in a critical manner the essays that were recently published in an edited volume titled Taino Revival, Critical Perspectives on Puerto Rican Identity and Cultural Politics, which is edited by yours truly and published by Marcus Wiener. And I was hoping that there would be a table here with copies of the book, but I understand that that didn't work out. Anyway, the book will will be appearing in bookstores in the near future if it hasn't appeared yet, and will also be sold through the internet through Amazon.com and BarnesandNoble.com, etc. Okay, this first part will be followed by a second segment in which the panelists will focus on the status of current research on Taino Native American cultural heritage in the Caribbean and its impact on Taino Native American cultural resurgence in both the United States and the Caribbean. And then subsequent to the second part, there will be a concluding section or segment for a question and answer. We'll have a question and answer period and a roundtable discussion that hopefully will link the two earlier segments of the panel session together in some sort of coherent or comprehensive manner. What I'd like to do now is introduce the panelists. At the far end of the table from where I'm standing, we have Dr. Pedro Fergo, who is a professor affiliated with the Department of Black Studies at Portland State University in Oregon. He is the author of The Politics of Taino Indian Heritage in the Post-Quincentennial Dominican Republic, which was his doctoral dissertation, And he is also a co-editor with John Weeks of another book entitled The Ancient Caribbean, a research guide to ancient civilizations, published by Garland Press in 1994, and he's also published some articles in academic journals. To his left, and to the audience's and to the right of Dr. Furbell, as far as the audience perspective is concerned, we have Ms. Naniki Reyes Ocasio of El Caney del Quinto Mundo in Puerto Rico, which, as I understand it, is a holistic farm that produces coffee, organic foods, medicinal plants, and other products, and which also serves as a center for teaching, ceremonials, and advice on Taino heritage and culture. In 1995, Ms. Reyes Ocasio received official recognition from the former governor of Puerto Rico, Pedro Rosselló, for her contributions and her work in advancing our knowledge of Taino heritage and culture. And then, from the person closest to me in the table, on your right, is Mr. Roberto Mugaro Borrero. Mr. Borrero is an artist in various media, painting, sculpture, printmaking, etc., and is currently the Indigenous and Native American Coordinator for Multicultural Programs in the Education Department here at the museum. Mr. Borrero also functions as a representative of the United Confederation of Taino People and is the editor and publisher of the newsletter La Voz del Pueblo Taino. At least the last time I looked, he was still the editor. And Mr. Borrero also wrote an essay in the Taino Revival book, which responds to the criticisms of the movement, so to speak, as articulated in a 1998 Museo del Barrio panel session by the other authors in the book. Now, there are actually two versions of this book. There was an earlier version that was published by the Center for Puerto Rican Studies at Hunter College when I was the director there, based on this panel session that I made reference to, which took place at the Museo del Barrio in February of 1998. The current version just came out. It's slightly different, well, somewhat different in format, with more pictures and better artistic and production values, and a different introductory essay which I wrote. So if you're interested in purchasing the book or obtaining the book in the future, I would suggest that you try to obtain the newer second version that just came out. Okay, and I think without any further ado, we can jump into this first section of the first segment of the panel session, which will evaluate the book in a critical manner, and we can start with Dr. Furbell. Okay.
Thank you. It's great to be sitting here with Roberto and Aniki. I feel a little uncomfortable being in this position. I'm used to being in meetings where we all sit together in a circle, because I think one of the critiques that I'm going to present of this book has to do with the authoritative academic voice and just how it's somewhat ungrounded in this larger debate about or conversation about identity. So bear with me, like I feel uncomfortable in this position up on the stage. The only thing that I have going here is that I'm sitting next to some friends, and that feels good. But I want you to know that the words that I have to say, the authority that puts me up at this table, doesn't have to do with my PhD in anthropology. It's true that I have spent some time in Santo Domingo as an anthropologist, conducting research, looking at these issues of Taino identity and survival and revival. But it's not because of the authoritative voice that I have as an academic that my words might resonate or make sense or not make sense. My words are a product of experiences, of conversations with countless people and their academics, their voices that I might have read in books, their people who are sitting next to me, and their people who, like you in the audience, people from different walks of life. They represent a diversity of opinions. And a lot of that's not represented are a lot of campesinos, people from the countryside, who've never entered into a museum or into a university, or some of them not even to schools, but who have a great amount of knowledge. And I've learned quite a bit from them. And while I don't want to speak for them, I will let their words speak through my words, because that's where a lot of my knowledge comes from. So I just want to acknowledge that. And acknowledge also that my own ancestors and community members, my family's come out here to meet me today, so I'm a little bit nervous too for that reason. But I want to acknowledge their presence here in this room. I want to thank Roberto for putting this together, and it's a great pleasure to be sitting here with Manique, who I haven't seen in a few years, and Roberto too. We spent some time walking in the mountains, and now we're like sitting here at the table, you know, it's a little different. So with that, I have spent about 5 years studying this question of Taino survival while living and working in the Dominican Republic. I worked at a historical archive where I would be involved in the presentation of the Taino past, as well as the African past and the Spanish past and the Creole past, the mix of those three cultures. It's often called the roots of, just like in Puerto Rico, they talk about three cultural roots. There's an interesting intersection with identity that has to do with national politics, where the nation state has the ability and the church has the ability to tell people who they are. And that happens through textbooks, through museum presentations, through governmental decrees. And I was sort of involved in that, except I was involved in a way where I was trying to take all of that and try to look between the lines and figure out what's the real history, what is the real culture. I had an ability to do that partly because I came from a different place, from Western culture. And I began to realize that Western participation in a global economy had a huge effect on local conceptions of culture. And in situations of incredible poverty and terror, such as those in many situations of the Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico, it's hard to concentrate on culture because survival takes precedence. This is a really important point because the Taino people have been in a state of struggle for their own survival since 1492. And I think one critique of all of the articles in the book, except Roberto's, they don't situate the Taino struggle within these 500 years of tragedy and terror and the contemporary tragedy and terror that continues. I should get down to a few particulars. I only have 10 minutes, right?
No,
I
don't
want to take a minute. I got one?
Yeah, you did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, because I love the idea of us having conversation, too. I see a few...
We have a long period of time. We have about 3 hours.
Excellent.
And I think at one point we should take a break. Probably after this first segment, we should take maybe like a 10-minute break and then continue.
Great. Okay, well, I see a few kind of areas that we can critique different articles in the book. One is the academic voice versus the voice of the people. Another is the whole concept of nation-state identity politics. And that has to do with the book is titled Taino Revival, Critical Perspectives on Puerto Rican Identity and Cultural Politics. I think that it could have been more clearly written, especially with Davila and Duany's articles. They're talking about conceptions of identity that come from nation-state. They're talking about books that people have written or decrees of the nation that have to do with creating a myth of national identity. So anytime they're talking about mythology of three roots and a harmonizing effect of the national identity, they're talking about it from a perspective of a national story. It's very similar. You can look at American history in the same way. There's certain mythologies of our history that are designed in many ways to control the people. Davila Right. I think it's pretty much, it could sum up the whole context of the book. Duani requotes Davila by saying, "I'll approach cultural nationalism not as an apolitical development, but as part of a shift in the terrain of political action to the realm of culture and cultural politics, where the idiom of culture constitutes a dominant discourse to advance debate and legitimize conflicting claims." I think that's a really complex way of just saying you do cultural things in order to get something from them. Culture is inherently political. I think this is the way Davila and Duani are defining identity. That if there's any concept of strengthening your identity, whether that's identifying with an ancestor, or making cassava bread, or painting a picture with a Taino theme, that you've got a political agenda behind it. I think in some ways that's an insulting discourse. It's legitimate for an academic to talk about that in terms of nation states. And I'd love to do that. Like, we can deconstruct Thanksgiving and Columbus Day. We can talk about American history and ask, like, is this really the history of the people of the Americas? That's a really interesting conversation to have. And I want to think that that's the conversation that Davila and Duani are trying to forward. They're trying to understand how Puerto Rico has manipulated the identity of the nation state in order to control the people. That's a really good conversation, because that's happened in all colonial arenas in the Americas. And that's important to have that conversation. But I think that conversation is very distinct from the conversation about people having the ability to identify with their ancestry or with the culture of their ancestors. I wrote a little thing here just saying that my time living in the campos of the Dominican Republic gave me this deeper understanding of identity within the colonized condition. It made me question concepts that I was taught to take for granted, like what is civilization, what is progress, what is health, what is wealth, what is community, and what is home. And I also became aware of the true sites of struggle for personal and shared identity. Reading the academic essays like the ones we're critiquing today suggests that the sites of struggle are in the halls of museums, universities, and libraries, and on the level of the nation state. And this is where I totally disagree. There's no doubt that those sites of power do have an influence on our concepts of identity. But I believe the true sites of struggle are in the hearts and minds of the people. That's to say that despite the influence of church and state, individuals continue to find their identity as it speaks to them. And if any anthropologist, academic, or politician should presume the authority to tell a person who they are and who they are not, I would suggest that they look in a mirror and account for themselves first. That's my critique. Does that sound right? Let's get a little call and response. That's where I'm coming from. I think it's really legitimate that people have the ability to identify with their ancestors. And I think living in colonial societies has taken that freedom, that ability away from us. And I think it's a key point. And in the book, to just gloss over that and say, no, identity is all about nation state. And if you're going to identify with your culture or promote a certain culture over another, that means that you've got some political agenda behind you. That's a very dangerous thing to say. And in many cases, it's insulting. And I think Davila refers to whether the Taino revival movement could be seen as a New Age fad or a curiosity to be laughed at. It's like, come on, like, do we have to take this discourse seriously? Like, if that's where you're coming from, you know, then let's focus on the critique of the nation state. That's legitimate. But if you're going to flip it around and not see that people have the ability to come together and identify as they have for thousands of years, it's hard to take that writing seriously. Another critique is just straight up, a lot of the researchers haven't done too much research on the actual knowledge. They don't have much knowledge of the history or the archaeology of the colonial period and resistance. Whether in Puerto Rico or the rest of the Caribbean. There's no discussion of creolization or transculturation as survival strategies. There's no discussion of Maroon heritage. they're very quick to point out that Puerto Ricans are mixed people, and yet they don't discuss the diversity of that mixing in the different areas of Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico represents a diversity of histories based on localities. You go to different parts of Puerto Rico and people are different, and it's for historical reasons. A lot of those reasons have to do with proximity to certain geographic resources, or history having to do with a plantation system, having to do with this maroon history, with people saying, I've had enough of this, I'm going out to the mountains and trying to figure out how to live outside of colonial society. There's these different histories that have happened in different places, and the authors, especially Davila and Duany, kind of make a monolithic history. It's too bad that we don't have, nobody's here to represent the other voices.
Except for Gabriel.
Okay.
I'm sort of in the uncomfortable position of being here and eventually have to explain what my colleagues are really concerned about. And I, of course, I have some concerns too, as some of you know, since I have my criticisms. They were invited, they were asked to participate, but I was told that they had moved beyond this issue and were doing research in other areas, other themes, other topics. So I don't believe my colleagues or the people who participated in the edited volume are here today. So I'm sorry about that.
But they were invited.
Yeah, there's certain things that are said in Miriam Jimenez Roman's article about the Tainos, referring to the Pequot and other native people who have had some success in coming together and asserting their identity as native people. She says that the Tainos, however, make identical claims without any historical foundation. To say that the contemporary Tainos don't have any historical foundation is like it's embarrassing. Like, I don't know what to say back to that. That's like a huge disconnect. That shows to me a lack of doing any historical research on the topic of continuity and survival. So there's some, well, we'll talk more about what people have been doing in those areas, whether it's about looking at the anthropology of Taino survival, or there's some fantastic work of a colleague in Santo Domingo who's working on census records and finding all of these references to Taino people, but it's all between the lines of history. It's not in the cronistas. If you just read the chronicles of the Spanish colonialists, you end up with the Spanish colonial discourse on Tainos. And it was in their best interest to make the Taino extinct. So if that's going to be the source of our history lesson, well, that's what we're going to come out with. So it's difficult for me to critique that. And there's another statement in her article about that we find the overwhelming majority of self-identified Tainos living in the United States. Well, it's how do you define someone who's Taino? There are a lot of people in the campos of Santo Domingo who I know who identify with their Taino roots, whether it's biology, because there's culture and biology. Some people identify with their ancestors straight up. They look in the mirror and they say, well, I am product of my blood ancestors, and I respect those ancestors. Those ancestors were native people, and they might have also been African people, and they might have been European people, but they might identify more with the native Taino people because they're in the campo struggling, just like their Taino ancestors had to struggle. They're farming the way their Taino ancestors farmed. They're finding the medicinal herbs like their Taino ancestors did, and they're disempowered like their Taino ancestors. How do you become empowered? You go to the city, try to go to Nueva York. You know, like that's about contemporary globalization, which is just a more modern form of colonialism. So I disagree strongly with that statement. And that these are statements that are assumptions within the chapters. So it's hard to see their conclusions without addressing those basic assumptions.
You know, I for one have not read this book. What got me about the symposium was that it consisted of this idea of a Taino revival. I think I don't know if anyone else, but it would be helpful for me to define what do you mean by a Taino revival in contemporary society? And then kind of putting it into context.
Yeah, you know, the book is called Taino Revival, and I'm thinking that there's a difference between a revival and a Taino survival. I think we might, that's a good question. That's something that researchers haven't yet addressed, and that's part of the problem of this book. They're just assuming a concept of Taino revival without really defining what that term is. I think there is a survival, for me, is to see the same cultural forms that exist over time. So something survives, like the ability to make cassava bread from yucca flour. That comes from, that's deep within the Taino culture. And that's a survival that we still have today. If an area has stopped making that cassava bread from yucca flour because of the importation of wheat and wheat bread, they say, well, it's just not worth making it anymore. But then if people get together and say, you know, we really like that cassava bread more because it tastes better, it's fresher, it won't get moldy, and there's something about it on Christmas time or, you know, when there's a funeral or a marriage, we just want to have that cassava bread around, and then they start to do it again. I think that's a revival. That's how I think I might define it. But it's definitely, that's a point that I think one of the big critiques of the book, and that's a good starting point for conversation, as opposed to an end point saying this is what it's all about.
Yes.
It's also interesting, I think, as you're pointing out, is this on?
Yeah.
That the use of revival came from the people who wrote the articles. However, they also admit to not having done any research. Understand? So their focal point when they wrote the articles was not to look at the continuity of Taino people, but rather, as Peter has said, you know, to look at it from, at least from my perspective, from a colonial framework, which is what they did, using what already exists in writing and not really taking the initiative to do further research or to talk to me or to talk to the many other Taino people who they knew and who they had access to. So revival, that word didn't come from us. It came from them, and then they didn't even take, at least from my perspective, their work seriously enough, you know, to do the research.
But I've always heard that the Taino, you know, one thing that intrigued me too was that I've always heard from my family, from Puerto Ricans, that the Taino people are extinct. So I mean, this kind of got me when I saw this, you know, that, what that meant.
I just wanted to add to that also because as a contributor to the book, I was in the same position that you are now, sitting out in the audience at the symposium. And while listening to this, understanding at least who I am, who my family is, and understanding about my own family history, of course I was very concerned. And besides the level of activism that I've had also in education, on dealing with that statement that you just made about the non-existence of a native population, not only in Puerto Rico, but throughout the Caribbean islands. I mean, and that statement goes on beyond the Caribbean islands, throughout the Americas, as you can see why they say, well, the Mayas were here, they built the pyramids, but they're gone. But meanwhile, everyone around the town is Maya, they acknowledge themselves as Maya, and you see that when you go on vacation to Cancun. But yet, in the areas themselves, there will be stuff written in Spanish, English, and also Maya. But yet the Maya were extinct after a certain point. What my perspective on that idea of revival was, you know, being part of the coordination of bringing this second part to that original conference here to the museum, I didn't oppose the title Taino Revival because I thought that was an important starting point that we can all use as a basis of discussion. Because I think that, and I made a note just before about it, because I thought somebody might bring that up also, that Taino Revivalism, the concept itself, and which is the title of the book here, from my perspective, and from the perspective that Naniki just said to you, is not really correct, as it's not in the holistic sense. In other words, we can't say Taino revival, in my opinion, we can say Taino revival has occurred because of people, not the people who were, Pedro was mentioning, but from an academic standpoint, from a nationalist standpoint, from the idea of building new countries and new nations like Puerto Rico, Santo Domingo, Jamaica, what have you. These idea of Taino revival has, you know, come from the educational system, and meaning that these people who wrote these papers in the book, that's how the last panel was presented. There was a group of academics who presented papers to the public. The papers were not available for the public beforehand, and so we just had to sit in the audience and listen to what they said, and then we had the opportunity to ask and make comments afterwards. But I think what they were bringing up was mostly what I saw in the book, was that as countries started to define themselves, people appropriated indigenous imagery, meaning maybe the symbolism, whether they wanted to set up a museum to engage tourism, or even in a nationalist sense that saying that, oh well, like the Indians, we want to be free from Spain, or we want to be free from England, you know, we want to be free from France, whatever island you might be in. So that the nationalists also took the idea of imagery, indigenous imagery, away from the people and used it for their own purposes. And the same thing with education, because the educators themselves, we have to remember that what were the process of education and their credentials for being educators? It didn't come from the people. Again, it came from an outside source. In the Caribbean islands, who were the first educators? They were the people who were sponsored by the church. It was mostly Catholic schools in the beginning, and later different denominations who came in. But again, where did they learn this educational process? They brought it over from Europe. And if you look at from 1492 to where we are now, this whole idea of education was based on a European concept of education that came over with the colonialists. And what was happening during that same time? The Inquisition. They were leaving that kind of paradigm and coming over here to the Americas with that. And I'm not saying that every educator or every religious advocate was wrong or that didn't try to say something different. But we're talking about a majority, a paradigm of thought that was imposed upon the people. When you mention things about Puerto Rico, I think Gabrielle can back up this statement of mine, because the Center for Puerto Rican Studies stated that very early on, when the United States came to Puerto Rico in 1898, they did censuses about the educational system in, for example, Puerto Rico. And right in the early 1900s, I think there was just a very small percentage of the population who was quote-unquote literate. That means only 5% of the population, I believe it was, of Puerto Rico was literate in the early 1900s. So all these years of history and on academics giving dialogue, who were they talking to? They were not talking to, I know, our grandfathers or our grandmothers, because I know even in my own family, my little brother's right out there, my grandmother had to leave school at a very early age to take care of children. And that's when you brought up the idea of survival, which I think is so important, which the academics did not want to address, and they say it, that they don't want to talk about Taino survival. You see? So we're not allowing ourselves to even understand the history and the process of who we are. And so for me and for other people that I've been in contact, I can understand the idea of revival when we talk about artisans maybe coming in and using Taino imagery or the idea of Tainos and reviving that and coming in. But when you come from a family that has an oral tradition, and in the past you were not allowed to express it. Why? Because, you know, the Indians, unlike what many people think about what we have now, we have a romantic idea of Indians because of Hollywood and different things, but in Latin America it's very, very evident and still practiced today that there's a great amount of discrimination for being Indian. And being Indian is always seen as the lowest form of development in a country. And meaning that if you want to equate yourself with an Indian, you don't want to develop. You don't want to go past that. You just want to stay jumping around, naked, running around with feathers, and whatever else concept they want to impose upon you from Hollywood. You see? So there's been a long time reason why people in their families have kept that, well, yeah, well, we're Indians, but you better not talk about that. Then the church itself was also a big influence. Anything you did outside the church paradigm was seen as diabolical, meaning that you're with the devil, or, you know, that's all evil stuff you're doing. So a lot of these things. So what I'm saying, that for me, I can accept the term Taino revival if we look at it in a certain sense, from people who are appropriating indigenous imagery and promoting that through education, government, and so forth. But for me as a Taino person, it's a matter of affirmation. We are affirming ourselves, and we have the right, because maybe in the past my grandmother could not say that, or somebody, but today I do have the right to say that. And we know that that's a fact, because even the United Nations, which is supposed to be the international standard for the world of civilized people, quote unquote, mm-hmm. has set basic human rights standards. And the idea of self-determination, it is a basic human right for all people. So I'd say that while we are discussing Taino revival, we have to look at specifically where that term is coming from and what that term means. But from a grassroots perspective, from a regular person, I'm just affirming my identity, and I have the right to do that.
I think the other aspect of the use of imagery, which the presenters could have focused on, is that the use of our imagery is precisely what lends itself to the disappearance of cultures. It also trivializes, and actually erases the actual experiences of indigenous people. Say, now you don't hear the voices of indigenous people because they've been trivialized to such an extent that the only thing that you're gonna come to look at or to try to find is someone with a feather, not a person who lives, breathes, marries, has children, and has a viable culture, one that they've been living for years and years and years. And it also, they lend themselves, at least from my perspective, they tread very dangerous ground with respect to indigenous people, because by trivializing us, they lend them the support to the extinction and the whole myth about the dying race, which then allows people to continue to desecrate our ancestral burial grounds, to use our bones. Now that to me is a very emotional and painful experience. And that's what happens when academics trivialize our expression and the truth about our continuity as a people, because then when we go before governments and we say, you stop desecrating my ancestors, you let me put them back in the ground, they need to go back home. This is the kind of thing that then says, who are you? You are extinct. What are you reclaiming? And when you say that I'm only after money, well, let me tell you that being Indian or claiming Indian roots or tradition or heritage has never been a you pass, go collect $200. So the whole fallacy about us trying to construct a path to whiteness is about as bizarre as a theory as I've ever heard. You know, because being Indian has never been something that has allowed you to access white American privilege. Ask the North American Indians in this country, who are nation states, which also they trivialize because they place them within the context of racial politics. They are nation people with treaties and nation-state relations. A very different position to be in. So this to me is so dangerous, because I'm fighting now to return my ancestors to their mother. And if you trivialize me, then you disempower my voice. And I won't stand for that. I won't stand for that.
Something else coupled with this idea that the Taino was extinct. This idea too that the Taino became extinct because they refused to be slaves, which is that this, although there was this denigration okay, this, about this extension myth. There was also this idea that they were heroic in some way.
I think that what you're saying is the stories about our ancestors who chose to go back to the mother, it's a different concept. That also gets distorted. It gets placed within the concept of suicide. And it doesn't belong there. There was no fear about death, about returning home, about, you know, going back to the place of the Gorné. And what's interesting about that is that many people will say that it's the Dominican friars, you know, who brought this whole quest for freedom to the Americas. Well, that's, it's not true. I was going to say something else, but I had to restrain you. That's a fallacy. It is precisely their observation of the deepness and the deeply felt sense of freedom and autonomy and sovereignty that our ancestors exhibited in the face of torture, in the face of watching your ancestors get hung up like a pig, their buttocks and their legs slit open, the dogs set upon them to feed upon them before they are burnt. And it was precisely the strength and that deeply ingrained sense of sovereignty that inflamed the Dominican friars to seek within their own spirits that sense of dignity and sovereignty that they saw exhibited by our people. So there's many fallacies that we as a people have a responsibility to do away with, you know? And that's part of why we're here. You know, I won't let no one else speak for me or for my ancestors or for my grandmother or for my grandbabies. You know, that's my job. And if you want to be an academician, then you better come speak to me. You better come see my family. You know, you better come to the mountains. Peter did it, and he found it. The people are there, they're living. You know, whether they're living the same way that we did 500 years ago is really not the point. There ain't a person or a culture or a people who are living the way they did 500 years ago. It's a fallacy. We've all encountered other people. We've all taken the gifts that those people have brought to us with perhaps new information. And we've incorporated it because as a developing people, you do that. You'd be foolish not to. So that to me is the danger of this kind of
promotion of
the myth of extinction.
Let me complicate things a little. There's the issue of extinction. The extinction of the Taino and Native American population in Spanish-speaking Caribbean, Cuba, Puerto Rico, and the Dominican Republic, this idea that they became extinct after the 1530s or the 1550s is no longer accepted by the younger generation of academics that are now beginning to publish articles and books on the subject matter. This issue of the extinction of the Tainos is essentially based on the old scholarship articulated by the old academic establishment, people like Ricardo Alegría, for example, in Puerto Rico and some others. So that now the younger generation of scholars is accepting the notion of Taino survival. Okay. However, they tend to see the academics at this point, based on the evidence that they're examining, see Taino survival as cultural, not necessarily historical. So that for the most part, they see a disconnect, and certainly not genetic, which brings up all kinds of controversial issues that we might discuss later on. Okay, so I just wanted to say that. And with regard to the Mayas in in Mexico, and specifically in Yucatan and in Chiapas and places like that. Academics in general, maybe not tourists or the general public, have accepted the notion that the Mayas have survived as a distinct group. And that's certainly been recognized in the writings that have been articulated in recent years with regard to the rising, the uprisings of the Zapatista movement in Chiapas, which is clearly rooted in the Maya communities of the of that particular highland region of southeastern Mexico. Who wants to?
I have all of this. I had actually brought a story to share with you about the prophecy of exactly what we're seeing today. The affirmation of the continuity of our people. But within that story, because I say that I brought not just my voice, but that the voices of our ancestors have traversed time and space to speak through me and through all the other Taino people. But also, if we needed to find some historical documentation, of the continuity of the Taino people, it's there. I don't know where the academicians are looking. I found it, and I have a long list of sites, and I'd like to share at least a few so that you all can get a sense of, you need to do your search, because they look for what they need to confirm their proposition. The other thing is that people like Alegría and other so-called scholars have been one of the biggest collectionists of our artifacts, and so they have vested interest in continuing the myth of extinction. Museums have vested interest in continuing the myth of extinction, because then their pieces are no longer they have no longer legitimate claim to that, because there's a people who can come and say to them, look, this is ours. We want it back. We're grateful you've kept it. Pray, that's mine. I want that back on the land. If it was made there, it has a purpose and a reason, and so it needs to go back. But if you need to have a documented history, I'd like to share some sites with you. While the Spanish chroniclers declare in 1503 that the king's decree freeing the Indian slaves after 11 years of contact comes too late to preserve them as a distinct group of aborigines, right? In 1513, a royal order directed that special teachers teach the sons of the chiefs of Borique Latin grammar. Then who is it, if we're extinct in 1503, who is the king ordering to teach Latin to? Okay, that's one piece, okay? Then in 1519, the king orders the newly appointed juez de residencia to San Juan de Puerto Rico to conduct social experiments to determine whether the Indians could live like Christian neighbors in Castile. If there's no Indians, who is he talking about? Okay, I'm going to take a big leap in here, right? In 1582, another point at which they claim the extinction of Taino people, the governor of Puerto Rico says not one Boriqueño remained on the island. 4 years later, in 1586, the bishop declares that the Indians are ill-conceived heathens. Nothing is more likely than that the Indians, induced by the promise of liberty of conscience, that they should leave the Catholic Church and fall back into idolatry. So who is the king writing about? Okay, 13 years later in 1599, when the Earl of Cumberland had captured San Juan, the king sent an armada commanded by General Coloma to reconquer Puerto Rico. And what does he find in the city of San Juan? Taino people. 200 years later in 1799, the census indicates that there are 2,000 families in Las Indieras alone, okay? Then if we want to come a little further, a little closer to this history, in 1898, 4 months after
5 months after Belonging. The infamous General Nelson Miles arrives at Guanica, the first Puerto Rican Indian classified as such by the U.S. Census. Juan Sultana is taken from his homeland on a military ship and brought to an Indian boarding school in the United States. Okay? So, o sea, tenemos, you know, the history is there. In 1903, Jesse Walter Fuchs revisits Caguana, and what does he find? He finds that the ceremonial practices of Taino people are continuing to be done at Caguanas. What does the first American governor do in Puerto Rico? He outlaws that and orders the building of the first cemeteries in Puerto Rico. Caguana is in Utuado. The Caguana is a ceremonial center, I'm sorry. So what I'm saying to you is that the pieces are there. They're there for you to find. But you have to look because they've been trying to hide it from us for so long. I'm going to bring you up to date. In 1995, the governor, José Yo, we had an international gathering of indigenous peace elders on the island of Puerto Rico, right? He greets, and I have the letter, he greets this delegation on behalf of the Taino people, and in his words, el pueblo propio mío. So he makes, in his opening welcoming to this group of indigenous elders, a distinction between recognizing the Taino people and his own. Okay? So as I brought you through a few little pages of ancient history up to modern history, and it's there.
Does anyone publish anything about this?
Well, as a matter of fact, if you look at this book, there's one chapter in there that talks a little bit about that, and I happen to mention a few things, but I'm glad that Peter is here also, and because of his focus now where he's teaching, and I'm sure these issues have come up, but I think one important thing, because we were talking about this book, and that was one of the things that the academics refused to do, just cite continuity of cultural survival, of not only the cultural survival, but the survival of people, and how many times that's referenced to in historical documents. They seem to think that all of our statements or all of our affirmations coming from what Peter had mentioned earlier, from just the Spanish chronicles, and if you don't know what we're talking about by that, meaning that in the very early years of colonialism, Christopher Columbus and onward, many of the people who came with him from whatever background, from Spain, England, or what have you, wrote down what they were seeing and wrote down what was going on, and they call those historical chronicles by quote-unquote eyewitnesses of the period. Now, I think one of the other important issues that was brought up in this book that really needs to be addressed, and it's not only for people who affirm themselves as Taino or Native or what have you, but the idea, and I think Gabrielle and I were discussing this the other day, the whole notion of race itself and pitting races, quote unquote races, against each other. From an indigenous standpoint, the idea of race as a concept doesn't exist. You know, this is a constructed concept that came over for people to break down, to lessen their access, or to allow people to gain access in society. How can I validate that that statement? When the Spaniards came over, and the first, quote-unquote, what they call Creoles started to develop, meaning that they were Spaniards. This is the word Creole, where it comes from, meaning when you were born, your family came from somewhere else, like Spain, England, France. They came over to another country that they were colonizing, and then those people got to that country, and their kids are there. They still considered them at that some point aligned with that quote-unquote mother country, but they became a class in themselves. And what happened was, why a lot of revolutionary movements started in the Caribbean and so forth, was because those people who developed that Creole class did not want to send the money anymore back to those original places where they come from. Why should they have to take out money and economics and resources and send it to a king or somebody else, when they could have control of it here. It doesn't mean that they were empowering the little people or the workers who were making their money, going into the mines, growing their vegetables, growing their sugar cane and so forth. But why should they send the money out? So this is where a lot of this discourse about nationalism has to start, and we have to recognize that, about what is Creole. Then we have to also recognize where the term Latino comes from. If you look in the historical documents, the first time that the word Latino appears is when they make reference to Indians who were taught Spanish. And this is documented in their own history. So the term Latino comes from Indians who could speak Spanish. And I don't see any difference of that today, because I think, you know, we could speak Spanish though. You know, so the term Latino also amplifies that discourse. Why I'm saying all this is because you have different concepts coming in, but basically the concept of race. How do people see, when she was bringing up the census, and I know we've said this before about people arguing about the census and who are they counting, but because they have on the census, they have black, white, but the Spanish also set up, if you were, your mother was black and your father was white, you were something. If your father was black and your mother was an Indian, you were something else. If your mother was Indian and black, but married to a white guy, you're something else. And they had a whole list of names for those different pairings of people. And it's quite a list of names that go on and on. And this don't only happen in Puerto Rico and the Spanish-speaking Caribbean. It happened in Jamaica and in many other places too. And that's also documented. And I'm sorry that our other panelists could not make it here today because he was very ill. And he asked to express his apologies. Michael Auld, who comes from Jamaica and who has done a lot of research on this. And this is something that he's also brought out as well. Back to the point of what I'm saying, the idea of race. You know, we just had the U.S. Census, and so many people were confused about how to fill out the census. Am I this? Am I that? What do I put on as race? Do I acknowledge myself as ethnic? Or how do I do that? And within, I brought up the United Nations system before again, because I think it's important that we refer back to the UN, because they are, quote-unquote, supposed to be setting up international standards that are accepted by governments, academics, and so forth. And UNESCO, which is United Nations Educational, Science, and Cultural Organization, had this discourse a while back that the concept of race itself is not valid, that it's really a more of a construct, a social construct, than an actual scientific fact. And Gabrielle, I'm sure you can relay a little bit more about that. But why am I bringing it up, and what does that have to do with Tainos? Very simply, is that as a people, in the past and even up until today, we're trying, even though the world says this, you are black, you're white, you're this, but as a Taino person, as an indigenous person, we have to go beyond that. You know, we have to see it the way that our ancestors also saw it, because when the Spaniards had first come over, and Aniki had mentioned how the church had a very strong hand in the affairs of the time. There was a certain number of Hieronymite missionaries. And what they were instructed to do, and I have this written down in that chapter, was when they went to the Americas, they instructed the Spaniards, when they went to the Americas, to marry the daughters of the caciques, or marry the daughters of the chieftains. Why? Because then their sons would become the chieftains. Because if you look at the lines, the way that the matrilineal society was, the sons, or the way it would be set up, was that here is a quote-unquote Spaniard who could be white or who could be off-white. I don't know what color, because it could be any color, you know, if you really know the history of Spain. You know, it was not only quote-unquote white people living there. If you understand that, then you understand that a person from an outside community who could be whatever color, but let's, for all intents and purposes, quote-unquote white color, come into a community of native people, marry the daughter of a chieftain, and that son, that offspring, could be a leader of their community. You know, I think it speaks very highly on what they thought of race. Secondly, when Africans who were enslaved were brought over from what we now call Africa and brought to the Caribbean, many of these people did not just stand there and say, okay, well, we want to be enslaved, and they just happily went along with this. They fought against that, and there's documentation of that. Many of these people left those areas, and where did they go? They went into mountain communities, and they went with the native people. And there's documented evidence of American Indian, Caribbean Indian alliance with African peoples, and this is where this whole Cimarron or Maroon culture develops. You know, this idea, which they tried only to attribute to Africans resisting, but there was also native peoples resisting along with them. So Africans could also be adopted into this culture. Why? Because we had a sacred ceremony called Gwaith Diaw. Gwaith Diaw is the making of relations ceremony, meaning that you could come from whatever village or whatever Indian nation or anywhere else, come to a community in the Caribbean, and we could make relations by a ceremony which would involve, in one case, of where people would cut a certain part of their hands together and clasp their hands, and it's like a blood brother ceremony. Spaniards had something similar, compadrazo. And our communities also had that. So we could make a relationship with somebody, but that was part of a reciprocal. In other words, when you became a family relation, that means that if I take my canoe and row over to the next island, you know, you won't be there with an arrow saying, hey, wait a minute, who are you? You'll be like, hey, wait a minute, you're married to my cousin's sisters, you know, remember, we're family. Oh, okay, come on over. You know, mi casa es tu casa, my home is your home. You know, we still have that today, right? So making relations was also done with the Spaniards. When Ponce de Leon came over, one of the first things he did was make a relationship with Aguevana, who was one of the most politically powerful chieftains in the island. So they made a relationship, a reciprocal relationship, meaning that what was Aguevana's standpoint in that? Well, look, these guys have different kind of ships, they have metal, they have a lot of things that we don't really have, so it makes sense to want to trade with them. Of course I'll enter into this, but coming from the native perspective, you wouldn't think that you would break that bond because we're really family. You see, the Spaniards didn't have that. They said, well, we'll just make the bond with them, but we don't care if we break it or not. We're not interested in that. We're interested in economics, profit, taking over these people, making the most money that we can so that we're propped up to where we need to be, meaning that we're taking over this place. Say you're Latino, that's fine to me. I don't have a hang up about it. Some other people might have a hang up, but I know my history. And my history doesn't only just begin in 1492. You see, we had thousands of years already of history, and those islands were from wherever you're from. So that's why I'm saying that one of the main points in this book was trying to pit, or trying to say that just because I want to affirm myself as a Taino means that I don't want to be black. This is a point that was brought up by academics, PhDs, saying that this is the reason. Or if I didn't want to be black, then it means that I want to be white. You see? So this is what the dialogue that was going on in this book, which is why I think it's really important to understand that when we talk about race, you know, we have to think about where these things have developed and how it affects everybody in the world, not only just us, but the way we relate to each other all.
Words like race and culture, we're all of the same human race. We're one species. Race is synonymous with species. That's according to biologists, physical anthropologists. Physical anthropologists have pretty much figured out that when you talk about race, you're talking about politics. Because if you take a person who's supposedly white and a person who's supposedly black, what is that child? What does that child become? And you look at the history of human migrations, there's not been any time where human beings have been so isolated and unable to intermarry with other people that they've created a separate species. We are one species, and that's what anthropology says. So that means, okay, that's biology. And I think it's fair to talk about bloodlines like that. To some Indian people, some native people, bloodlines are very important. From what I understand, the Blackfeet Nation they care a lot about how much Blackfeet blood you have. Other Native people, it doesn't matter at all. I know a lot of Lakota people who have blonde hair and they're accepted as Lakota people. It doesn't matter, it's the culture. So there's like a distinction between your bloodlines. Who are your ancestors? And your culture. What are your customs and your beliefs? So there's diversity in the Native American community on those issues, first off. Okay. Then the race thing. So since race is not about biology, then what is race? Well, race is a system that's based on color preference that was designed by colonists, specifically if we're talking about American race, American racism. It happened with the earliest colonization of the Americas by European people on land that was where Native people lived, who were of a different color, who weren't quite as light as the European people. However, Roberto points out really well, Spanish people were a mix of a lot of different ancestries, Moorish ancestry, other African ancestries. And then the importation of African people, who tended to be, but were not all, of darker skin. That situation, that color-based system, where there's a power hierarchy with lighter-skinned people at top and darker-skinned people on the bottom, this is an artificial political trick designed to manipulate groups of people so that the people on top would stay on top. And what we have today, in our even here in the United States, we have this color-based system that's entrenched. Racism is something that's taken for granted. Racism exists within our very vocabularies. It exists within the ways we talk about census categories. It's huge. And privilege, white privilege that comes out of that, that's taken for granted, where people say, well, you know, everyone, every American should have two cars and whatever. That American dream is not the dream of all people who live in these borders. This is a dream that was designed by people at the top of the hierarchy, and that's where we get all these different mythologies about our history, about who we are. So we get immigrant people who are here for a generation or less, and they forget about what their culture is, or the history of the struggle of their ancestors on this land. You know, that Irish people weren't always white, Jewish people weren't always white, Swedish people weren't always white. There's some interesting work in race relations coming out right now. I'd be glad to share those resources with people if they're interested in that. But just showing those histories of the creation of whiteness and how that works on a nation state level. So back to the Taino. The Taino, okay, again, depends on the area. In some areas, there's a mix of people of African, European, and Native American ancestries. In other areas, it was just African and Native American. In others, it might have been just African. In others, it might have been just Native American. It was very different depending on where you go, even on an island like Puerto Rico, which isn't that large. And that has to be recognized. And that's why a lot of Taino people get into these huge conversations and confrontations about who they are. And a lot of people who have more African ancestry, they look at their Puerto Rican brothers and sisters and say, wait a minute, you're forgetting about your African ancestry, aren't you? And that's sort of the crux of what Duane and Davila are talking about. Roberto writes in his response, the absurd impression that one drop of African blood makes you black, but you need a whole lot more Indian blood to make you a real Indian. And I think he could have said that, like, if it's a drop of African blood makes you black, then you're talking about a drop of Indian blood would make you red. You know, if we're looking at racial categories, Indian might be more about culture. Africa is about culture, and black is about race. That's where it gets confusing. The critique that I'd say of the absurd impression is that it is an absurd impression, but it's been legally justified in courts of law. Here in the United States, turn of the century, Plessy versus Ferguson was a case that said that if you had 1/32nd blood quantity that was black, that means that you're black. It's like a legal precedent. Racism has been turned into a legal code in the United States. And I think, like, I want to challenge Roberto to get even a stronger handle on the race question, because even though it's an absurd impression, And like I said, as an anthropologist, like race is about politics. It has nothing to do with who you are, about your identity or your culture. But at the same time, we live in a hugely racist society. And African people are on the bottom of that hierarchy. That makes it such that, well, like I have a niece. My sister's husband is Jamaican. And my niece has as much blood as any of my children will have. If you look at my niece, you're going to say, oh, well, she's black. Like, that's because we live in a racist society. I look forward to the day when you look at her and you might ask, like, tell me more about your ancestry. Just like we should be asking about Taino people, or any mixed race people in the Americas, Lumbee people, Pequot people. There are a lot of mixed race people, even white people are mixed race people. We should be asking these questions about ancestry. Who are your ancestors? Do you know their history? And if you don't, do you know why you don't know it? Because that's where the national politics starts creeping in. The nation states don't want us to know who we are. The more we know who we are, the more we realize what we have in common. And the more we also realize who the ones are in power at the top of that pyramid.
I'd like to jump in.
Yeah, well, Gabriel has to jump in and then I'll jump in.
Comments about that. And I agree with Pedro's comments that the Tainos have to confront this race issue in a much stronger way than they have. Because there is still much confusion. Despite what the United Nations has said, despite what some teachers and college professors may say in the classroom, there is still much confusion with regard to our understanding of race and ethnicity and how race and ethnicity is used in modern societies, as Pedro has begun to explain it. And it also has to be understood that most people in the Caribbean and most people in this country, including the overwhelming majority of Latinos, have been taught and have been conditioned to believe that subdividing the human species into categories called races is an obviously natural thing to do. People in the Caribbean and in our country have been falsely taught and have been conditioned to believe that research in science and the biological sciences in particular can justify the subdivision of the human species into these discrete and simplistic racial categories that we hear all the time, black, white, or Caucasian, yellow or Asian, and red, or Native American, among other categories. The concept of race is taught and promoted and rarely criticized or rejected by media, in films, in music, in literature, on television, in the public schools, and especially in politics, where the concept of race and ethnicity are crudely manipulated, as we saw recently during the mayoral campaign that we just experienced here in New York. And even in the colleges and universities, faculty are often reluctant to confront the scientific fallacy of race, because the subject often raises seemingly sensitive or controversial issues. It also has to be recognized that in our society, victims of racism can sometimes benefit from racial identities. Affirmative action programs for certain racially defined groups in our society are an example of this phenomenon, and I'm not here to criticize affirmative action. In any case, and despite the statements and recommendations that have been made by UNESCO and the United Nations in general, which Roberto made reference to, and also other organizations such as the American Anthropological Association, the critique of race as an idea and as a scientific fallacy is still largely limited to certain college-level courses in anthropology or specialized high school-level courses or classes on race, taught usually by motivated teachers or faculty. The non-motivated don't normally get involved in discussions of these issues in our schools, colleges, and universities. And it also has to be remembered that there are still some, in fact, some of my colleagues would say many, teachers and faculty in our colleges and universities who still believe that the concept of race is valid from an intellectual and even scientific standpoint, despite the evidence to the contrary that Pedro made reference to. At my home institution, the City College, the City University of New York in Uptown Manhattan, we have a philosophy professor by the name of Michael Levin, who believes that so-called black people are inferior to so-called white people. And we also have an Africana studies professor, Leonard Jeffries, who seems to believe that so-called white people are inferior to so-called black people. I would say that because of the social, cultural, and political climate that prevails in our society, in the United States and also in the Caribbean, it is very difficult to separate the idea of a Native American, and by extension, a Taino, from the prevailing concepts of race that are held by most people in our societies. This difficulty in separating the concept of a Native American from the prevailing concepts of race is reflected in the statements that are made on several of the Taino internet websites with regard to membership and other issues, membership in the Taino tribes or groupings. For example, many of the internet websites have disclaimers or statements that repudiate racism, ethnocentrism, and concepts of race. But the same internet websites also include ideas and terminology that are clearly connected or rooted in concepts or ideas of ethnocentrism and traditional concepts of race, such as tribe, word tribe, ancestor, direct descendant, family tree, genealogy, original people, our people, blood, pure blood, blood type, Taino blood relative, Taino blood lines, which the phrase that Pedro referred to, the phrase we are still here, and so on. In the internet website, if you check the internet website of the Taino Turabo Aimako tribe of Borinquen, the following statements are made in the tribal charter with regard to membership in the group. It begins, the comments are the following, and I quote, "We do not deny petitioners membership based on issues of blood quantum or other tests of authenticity. We accept all Taino entities, whether they appear white, Asian, black, Indian, or any combination of two or more. We do not care if you have a multiplicity of ethnicities, and we recognize that we are now the Taino Rainbow People." Okay. All right, having said that, in other parts of the website, especially if you look at the membership application form of this group, the Taino Turabo Aimako, prospective members are still required to outline their family history with regard with the membership categories of the tribe defined as follows. Number one, Taino member. The Taino member must have a Taino blood relative from Borinquen or other locations. Number two, a non-Taino member defined as a Native American but from another tribe. Number three, another category of non-Taino member defined as an individual who is not a Native American at all. There are also other statements in the charter that make reference to persons who can or should demonstrate their Taino pedigree through documentation. And despite denials to the contrary, there are also statements in several of the internet websites that raise the issue of authenticity and legitimacy, this debate that Pedro was making reference to among different groups of Tainos or different individuals within the groupings. For example, there are the statements in the charter of the Taino Turabo Aimako tribe which say the following. We wish to express our happiness and warmth to those Boricuas that are seeking to retrace their Taino roots through our website. We do, however, wish to warn those looking for their roots to be mindful and discerning. There are many who claim to be Taino and or claim to know everything about the Taino and our culture. Some of these people who use information to set up scenarios and organizations in which to prey upon the naivete of unsuspecting people and will extort money and mentally abuse or brainwash them with a cultic mentality for their ill-gotten gain. And then there is also the issue of the photographs. In the case of the Taino Turabo Aimako tribe, the submission of a photograph with the application form is not required. However, applicants for membership in the Hatiboniko Taino Tribal Nation, or those persons who apply through the census registry form of the United Confederation of Taino People, are still, to this day, required to submit a 2x2 color inch photograph for consideration. And the question is, what is done with those photographs? Are those photographs being used as mechanisms for determining criteria for membership in a particular tribe or group? And at this point in time, as far as I can tell, it also appears that most, if not all, Taino websites with an included membership application form fail to define the criteria that is required for membership in the tribe or the group. So this issue of race, I think, really needs to be confronted in a more direct way, and it has to somehow be resolved, if it can be resolved, because I know in the courses that I teach at City College, when I raise the issue of Taino survivalism or Taino revivalism, the first reaction of students is connects the issue of Taino survivalism and or revivalism with the issue of race, and they have to be, some students sort of like have to be directed, unfortunately, into considering Taino survivalism or revivalism as being something more connected to culture and not connected to race or genetics. I guess I'll stop there for now.
Yeah, I'd like to say something. I think there's quite a number of issues that have come up from the time that Pedro spoke to the discourse that we just heard from Gabriel. One thing what I'd like to go back to was the statement in the book where Pedro had offered a critique of a certain section that I had written. And basically, I'll read you a little bit so that you can get more of the context of what was happening there. Roger Hernandez, who identified himself as a Taino from the neighborhood, and this was in reference to people just like yourself sitting in the audience, after they heard what they heard, they also wanted to say things and they were making comments from the floor. So Roger Hernandez, who identified himself as a Taino from the neighborhood, made the first comment from the floor. He told the scholars that although he was born in New York, there might be some who might not accept him as a New Yorker. Roger's back there, by the way. He also noted that the panelists were free to decide what he might be, but that his own people accepted him as Taino, and that was good enough for him. In this response, in the response to that statement, Dr. Peter Roberts, who identified himself as a black academic from Barbados, just so that you have it in context, he replied, why do you call yourself Taino when you are a mixture? Why are you focusing on the Taino only? And then what I wrote here was, I found this reply a little disconcerting and wondered how Dr. Roberts would feel if someone had asked him a similar question. I also wondered when this educated man, last thought about his own identity, particularly since many persons of African descent in the Caribbean are a mixture and retain Caucasian as well as indigenous ancestry. Overall, it appeared that Dr. Roberts and the other panelists were suggesting that if persons exhibit African physical traits, no one questions their African ancestry or their, and I have it in quotes, degree of blackness, regardless of their skin color, unless they are obviously white. This assumption and the overall attitude of the panelists leaves one with the absurd impression that it takes only a little African blood to make a person black, but it takes a whole lot of Indian blood to make a person a real Indian. What I was trying to say there, and maybe my mistake was not also putting the term black in quotes again, as I put it in quotes a little bit above it, but I thought maybe people would also get the inference, is that whether people are considered Indian or black, sometimes black does just not mean like Indian red. You know, there's also black is beautiful. We've heard the terminology before, but that could mean a person of various skin tones, not the color black per se. And I know that recently, even some Native Americans who I'm aware with here from the United States have also made these statements that we come from the original four peoples of the world, and the black peoples, the yellow peoples, the red peoples, and the white peoples. I personally don't agree with that kind of statement, but I know people who are revered in the Native American world who follow that philosophy. I think that our ancestors were talking about something a little different than, again, color. And I think the examples I brought before about how the Taino viewed this situation was very clear. We weren't looking at each other black, red, yellow, white, purple, green, blue. You know, we had a different idea. So I think my statement there was also alluding to the cultural context, but also what the academics in the book were presenting, because my statements also were a reaction to what they presented. I never got to review the papers per se. I was just in the audience, and my statements and my essay in the book came from my reaction of listening to them and listening to what they had to say. That's kind of dealing with what, and I'm sure Peter might have some sort of rebuttal. I don't know if I've made myself clear, but I think that it's important also to go back to what Gabriel was saying, and that he was saying that we have to define what race is. And I think that, let me tell you, I love Gabriel, and we have a very good friendship, but one of the biggest problems in the book I found was his introduction. And we hadn't had a time to really assess the introduction of the book, but I had various critiques of the way he introduced the whole topic, because I think that it really didn't, from my perspective, it didn't really cover what really had occurred or what the situation that is that we're really talking about. It came from his background also in sociology and also terminologies that and phenomenon that he's seen here in the United States and a situation that he's also reported on. I think that whole issue of they have to define themselves was also very prevalent with the other academics. Well, the Tainos have to be clear on what they mean by this. Well, in other words, they have to be clear, and how could they say this? They're putting something on us. And I see that it's funny that, Peter, you also have it circled here, that this person asked, the sentence was, I'll read you a little bit. Continuing on this theme, another member of the audience noted that certain comments made by the scholars suggesting that there has been no movement of African consciousness in Puerto Rico that compared to the current Taino movement for Taino reaffirmation. So this person asked if it was not the responsibility of the academic community to address and clarify this issue through proper education. So again, we're being asked to clarify a situation that the United States government can get straight. We're being asked to reclassify racism that our own teachers in our school, that he obviously admits now, can get straight. But yet it's the responsibility of the Taino people to clarify all this for the rest of the world so that we can straighten out what the issue of race is. I think that all of us know that within any community, within any society, there's different views. And the fact that one group that proclaims themselves a tribe or a certain, whatever way they describe themselves, does not make it everybody is doing that. And there's a very, he addressed the United Confederation of Taino People in a membership application, so to speak. If we read the application, quote unquote, carefully, it says census affidavit. Because of the way the system is set up here today, in the United States, in different areas, we have to address our issues, very important issues that we have. For example, Naniki brought this up earlier, about our ancestral remains and different things that we as a people have been taking to task now with the government, along with our affirmation of who we are. Right now, in the United States, there are certain things that you can do, but you have to be quote-unquote documented by the federal government as a quote-unquote Native person, Native American person. And the way you go through that documentation process is by having follow-up documentation. The government has to review this and allow and pass all these checklists. And this is how the Pequots, who are the group up in Connecticut who have the casino Foxwoods, were also able to regain, after they said that they were extinct, regain their status as a Native people because they passed a checklist. They were able to conform with the requirements that the U.S. federal government put forth on them. The reason why in our talks as a people, as a community, as a cultural group, as an ethnic group, however you want to describe it, I mean, these are all things that people have put on us. We're not putting that on ourselves. But we also have to conform with these certain paradigms that are set up with us here in the United States. The reason why our membership or Taino people have requested a certain, in other words, if you fill out an affidavit form for the United Confederation of Taino People, it's not us who are telling you you're Taino or not. It's a personal affirmation affidavit. In other words, there's certain things that are asked here, and that you're saying that I want to take part in this affirmation, and I want to be part of this community. So I'm telling you that I am Taino, and I want to be included in the list, so that when people who are lobbying for the rights of our community go forth to the government, we can also say, besides our own oral tradition, who tells us who we are, that we also have a historical continuity that we can document in history. Besides the historical documentation, we now also have quote-unquote scientific documentation by recent statements by certain scientific and educational entities in Puerto Rico who have now done DNA studies to connect us with the bones that they've been finding and that they have in their museums, and that these DNA is a linkage from those people who they have behind the glass cases to people who are alive today. You see, that wasn't a situation that I invented. That was a situation that somebody else invented and put upon us. So am I to deny that scientific or that academic validation of who I am in my overall case presentation to people who continue to say, I mean, Gabrielle said earlier that, well, most younger academics now understand that the Tainos did survive in various pockets or in various forms around the Caribbean. But that doesn't mean, excuse me?
Culturally,
right?
Cultural survival.
Right, there you go.
Certainly historical.
Right.
That's okay. The academic position.
Right, the academic position is that. So that means that they're not, you can walk like a red man, right? Talk like a red man, do religious things like a red man, but you ain't a red man, according to them. It walks like a duck, talks like a duck, but it ain't a duck, right? What I'm trying to say here is that if we're asking in this affidavit for people to present their selves the way they want to be, certain of our people have also been very entrenched along with Native Americans here in the United States. Why? Because in the migrations of our people, we've met Native American people here. We've formed alliances with Native Americans. And if you also review our website, you'll see that not only Native Americans, but throughout the hemisphere, our organization, our group, or whatever you want to call it, you know, the United Confederation of Taino people. We've been with our native brothers and sisters in Guyana, in Trinidad, in Dominica, throughout this hemisphere, and even as far away as Australia, relating to them as native people. They have no problems with us, we have no problems with them. You see, if somebody wants to come into this and be a part of this, sometimes here in the United States, they can't go into a powwow and sell their Taino crafts if they don't have identification or affiliation to a native organization, quote-unquote tribe, another word that was imposed upon us, without some kind of documentation. I'll give you an example. A very good friend of mine married a Pueblo Indian here. He calls himself an Indian, so I don't want to be derogatory by even using that term Indian. A Pueblo Indian from New Mexico. When she was a Taino woman from Puerto Rico. Now, we don't have the same federal recognition system that the United States Indians have, okay? When she went to go to the reservation, to live at the reservation, the Pueblo government, which is a government, as Naniki said earlier, said that, well, in order to register your child, the Pueblo government, as an Indian, we have to know if the baby's mother is an Indian. So what kind of documentation was she going to present? The government of Puerto Rico wasn't recognizing her as an Indian. The United States government wasn't recognizing her as an Indian. So she had to come back to her community. And so she asked me as a representative of the community, as a representative of an organization that has gone beyond recognition amongst Native communities throughout this hemisphere, to write her a letter on behalf of her people to say who she was, that she was indeed a Taino. I wrote this letter as a president of the United Confederation of Taino People, and that letter was accepted by the Pueblo government, and her child was known then and therefore as an Indian full blood, quote unquote, their title, not mine, full blood Indian person with all the rights due to Pueblo people. If we didn't have that card, if we didn't have that system, she might have had a problem, and that child might have not had the access to those entitlements that the Pueblos give them. So if we have a process of organizing ourselves, I'm not saying that the process is not flawed or cannot be flawed. I mean, we're going through this as any other people are going through this. We're also being inundated by racial terminologies, black, white, red, yellow, blue, but we can't be held responsible all the time to be put up on a pedestal before the rest of the world, even though we're trying to do that. You know, we're trying to make a difference by saying, hey, you know, this idea of color, this idea of race is not really traditionally the way the people were viewing it. So let's try to move beyond that. I can't help it if everybody else is moving on beyond that. And the other organizations I can't speak to. I'll give you a prime example. This system today, what was going on today, was advertised very heavily amongst the Taino community. There was an outrage about this book because of the positions of the scholars by saying with the anti, quote unquote, anti-Taino sentiment, that they said that this book should not be supported at all. So I find that very unfortunate that they would boycott this particular gathering because of this book, because I think they're doing a disservice to their own community. For me, it's very important to know what the academics are saying so that I can pose the contrary argument. And I could say, well, listen, if you have these concerns, this is what we're talking about. This is not, I don't know what everybody else is talking about. And if they're not here to speak for themselves, I can't speak for them either. I don't know why the Hatibunuko tribe calls themselves a tribe or why they've accepted that paradigm. You know, that's not my decision and that's not my judgment call, nor the people that I work with. And if you look at our site, we don't use that terminology. You know, the internet is a way to educate people, but it's also a way that where a lot of misinformation can come out too. And I think we have to also understand that. The educational system that we have today can be a very wonderful thing. You know, these kind of ideas, these forums, can be a wonderful thing for exchange and dialogue, but it doesn't mean that the systems themselves are not flawed. You mentioned the museum. Before, I mentioned the Taino DNA testing that was recently done in Puerto Rico. Before that DNA testing was done, you can go upstairs to the South American Indian Hall. There's a little diorama that says Taino for the Taino people, Caribbean indigenous peoples, and it says right on the bottom of that diorama, Taino genes can still be found in the present day population of some people in the Caribbean. They've already acknowledged that scientific continuity way before these tests in Puerto Rico came out. These genetic tests, you can go upstairs and find that. That's this institution here. You know, so we really have to be understanding. The other thing that I wanted, I'm sorry to take so much, but okay. While we were on the subject of Gabriel, is that he also pointed out that in his introduction that the Neo-Tainos, and again putting another terminology on top of the terminologies that we already have, the new Tainos, not acknowledging at all the arguments that we were presenting by saying that we do have a continuity in our own family tradition. There is a historical continuity. There is now a physical continuity that's been acknowledged by certain segments of the scientific community. So he made a statement in the introduction that we believe that we developed in isolation of everything. And I don't think, even in my chapter, states that that's one of the things that we have been vehemently protesting against, because they continuously say, oh, the Tainos and the people of the Caribbean just developed as a result of people, Arawaks, coming up from South America. You know, like there was a wall, a barrier that only let you come up this way in the islands. Right? But so people couldn't come this way, or people, when they knew how to make canoes that could hold over 150 people, they could travel using astrology, using the stars. They knew when to go on the water, when a hurricane would come, or when it wasn't going to come, you know? They knew all these things, but yet they can only travel from one group, one language, linguistic group from South America, and that's why we're really Arawaks, you know? That, I mean, it's absurd. If you look at a map of the Caribbean islands, it can't be anything but an influx of people from time immemorial. There are islands that are now submerged as the sea level has risen that allows very easy access from Central America right to Jamaica. People still today get on rinky-dink crafts trying to get to Florida or whatever it is, trying to escape their economic or whatever situation they have. They can make it to Florida, they can make it to the Bahamas, and we know by the quote-unquote refugees that are constantly taken into this country. So you can imagine if people who don't really have a seafaring ideology or knowledge get on these boats and these crafts, taking their lives into their hands to float out to try to get somewhere else, that here are people who for millennia knew how to travel the seas, you know, that they didn't interact with other people, it's insanity. You know, it's a real arrogance to think that we could not have had contact with other people. And myself and the presentation that I made in my essay would never assert that we developed in isolation back then or even now. We're not isolated now. The other thing was, Gabriel had mentioned that we're trying to revive the polytheistic religion of the Taino people. If you understand Taino culture, polytheism is another reference that is not valid. It doesn't make sense to a traditional standpoint. Las Casas, in his writings, Bartolomé de las Casas, who's one of these historical chroniclers that I mentioned, writes down, was it Las Casas or Pane? One of these early Spanish chroniclers writes down that, oh, the